Welcome to the class, students. We are going to start a new chapter, and that is health information and basic medical statistics. First, we are going to see in this chapter how health information in India is collected, the various sources, their advantages, their disadvantages, and later on we are going to deal with medical statistics. Definition of health information management system: a mechanism of collection, processing, analysis and transmission of information required for organizing and operating health services and also for research and training. That is the definition of health information and management services. The first part of this chapter would be the more or less theoretical part, and in the second part we will be talking a lot of substantial things of statistics. I know that everybody loves statistics, and because you love maths, you became a doctor, and therefore I am here to really again sort everything out, just give you what is required so that you ace in your examinations. So I'll attempt to do that, but I would require your undivided attention at least in the second part of this chapter. Coming back to the class, HIMS is a basic tool of management and a key input for progress of any society. The WHO requirements for HIMS are: the system should be population based, it should avoid unnecessarily collection of data, it should be problem oriented, it should employ functions and operational terms, it should express information briefly and imaginatively, and the system should also make provisions for feedback of data. So these are the criteria for good HIMS or a standard HIMS. Uses of health information: they are to measure the health status of the people and to quantify their health problems, for local, national and international comparisons of health status, for planning, administration and effective management of health services and programs, and for assessing whether health services are accomplishing their objectives or not. So these are the various uses of health information. You can also have it for assessing the attitudes and degree of satisfaction from the beneficiaries with the health system, and for research into a particular problem of health or disease. What are the sources of health information? The sources are, first and the most important source is census. I hope everybody knows census. Census is a nationwide collection of data done on a decade basis. So every 10 years we do it, the first year of the decade, in the first quarter of that year we have a census. It is an important source of health information. It is taken in most countries. Definition is: the total process of collecting, compiling, publishing demographic, economic and social data at peculiar times, that is census. The census primarily gives information like total population and its demographic breakdown, such as age, sex, ethnicity. So that is done by census. As I told you, it is held every 10 years in the first decade and in the first quarter of that year. Last census in India, if it is asked, was done in year 2011. The second source of numbers is registration of vital events. Registration keeps a continuous check on demographic change. If registration is complete, it is a very reliable source of data. You know that in India it is mandatory to register births and deaths. You get advertisements on your television for urging people to register their child's birth. So that is this, registration of vital events. United Nations has a definition for this, and it is a very long one, that is legal registration, statistical recording and occurrence of, and the collection, compilation, presentation, analysis and distribution of statistics pertaining to vital events. Do you want to learn it? No, you don't want to learn it. In 1873, Government of India passed the Births, Deaths and Marriages Registration Act, wherein there was a voluntary registration. The act provides for compulsory registration of births and deaths throughout the country and compilation of vital statistics in state to ensure the uniformity and comparability of data. So now it is mandatory, now it is a compulsory registration. Whose responsibility is reporting? The relatives and parents, and also the institutional heads. If the delivery is happening at an institution, it is the responsibility of that institutional head to report that delivery. Simultaneously, it is also the responsibility of the parents to report. Time limit are: for birth registration there is a time limit of 14 days, and for death registration there is a time limit of 7 days. After that, if a delay happens, then a fine of rupees 50 can be applied. The next method is the sample registration survey. It is a dual record system. consists of a continuous enumeration of births and deaths by an enumerator. That is, you record those births as they occur, and an independent survey which is carried out every 6 months by an investigator. So this is a dual check system. So I have a continuous record and an intermittent record, and then I match these two records if some data is missing in either of the two. The next source is hospital records, basic and primary source of information about diseases prevalent in the community. Again, there are numerous problems, like they provide information on those patients who seek medical care and not the whole population. Maybe the poorest have the maximum disease, but they cannot afford to come to a fancy hospital, and therefore their data would never be collected. Admission policy may vary from hospital to hospital. One hospital admits patients of gastroenteritis, the other one says, okay, give them ORS, treat them as outpatients. So that may vary. And population served by the hospitals cannot be defined. We don't know from where the patients come to the hospital. They are not from a well delineated geographical area. What don't we get here? We don't get the about the numerator and the denominator. We don't get the denominator. I don't know who is at risk. I don't know how many patients out of how much population. So the denominator is not clear if I get my data from hospital records. Health survey, it can be either a cross-sectional survey or an analytical study. So what are the methods of health survey? Health survey is another method of data collection. You can have a survey method. You can have a health interview survey, health examination survey, and health record survey. Again, nothing very complicated here. Those words itself tell you what they mean. The first one, health interview survey. It is a face-to-face interview. I want some information. I come to your place and I ask you. That is a health interview survey. Measure subjective phenomena such as perceived morbidity, disability, impairment, economic loss, and some other things which can be asked directly. National Sample Survey Organization conducts such interviews. This you should know. National Sample Survey Organization conducts health interview surveys. Health examination surveys. I do health examinations, and that is the survey carried out by doctors, technicians, and interviewers. Obviously, then it provides detailed information and valid information. Disadvantages obviously are that it is expensive and it cannot be carried out on a very large scale. I can't have my teams roaming on for all over India. The next method is health questionnaire survey. Again, exactly what it says it is. Health questionnaire. You hand them a questionnaire and they fill that questionnaire, give it back to you. Measure subjective phenomena. No interview is needed here. It is very simple and cheap. But the disadvantages are, you give the paper, they might give you back, or they might have some meal into it and give you back. So the follow-up or the response might not be very well. People might not help. Health record survey. You have health records maintained over the year. I look at those records, and that is health record survey. Collection of data from health records. It is the cheapest method, obviously, because everything is ready. Disadvantage is, estimates obtained are not population based. Reliability of data is questionable. Who recorded what for whom under what circumstances, if it was true or not, I really cannot vouch for that, and therefore it is questionable. And there is lack of uniformity and standardization in recording data. With that, we come to a part in community medicine all of us are very scared of. We start with biostatistics. What I will do here is, I'll make it really simple. I will talk only what is should know, what is expected of you to know, what would help you in the examinations and help you solve the questions. So let us have a crash course on biostatistics so that the subject we hate maybe becomes a subject we love. You have basically two types of data, you know, quantitative data and qualitative data. Quantitative data is, I can measure temperature, height, weight. That is a quantitative data. You are given a quantity. Qualitative data. Qualitative data is, I tell you about the quality. Quality again cannot be directly measured. Say for example, beauty. My girlfriend is more beautiful as compared to yours, and the other guy says, no, that is not true. Mine is hotter. And there is a debate. I cannot have a scale of 1 to 10 and your girlfriend is 8 and mine is 9, although we frequently do that, but that is not an acceptable method. Yours is 8, mine is 9 is not available, and therefore it is a quality. it cannot be directly measured. Those sorts of data which cannot be directly measured are called as qualitative data. The other example is oral hygiene. Types of data. Types of data you can have in qualitative data: nominal, ordinal, dichotomous. Very simply, very fast. Nominal, you have a name for it. I cannot arrange it. I am a Hindu, somebody is a Muslim, somebody is a Christian, somebody is a Jew. Okay, everybody is good, everybody is fine. It is a name. There is no order. So that is nominal data. Ordinal data, I have an order. Order is lower class, lower middle class, upper class. I have an order here. So infant, adolescents, adults, geriatrics, I have an order here. So I have a definitive order, and that set of data is called as ordinal data. Dichotomous data, two splits. So you have a dichotomous seat. Similarly, the answer is either yes or a no, or two answers, two possible answers. Are you a boy or a girl? You say maybe I am a boy, I am a girl. So you have two options here, either a boy or a girl. Okay, are you happy? Yes, no. So that is a dichotomous data wherein you have just two options, two possible options. Other types of data are primary data and secondary data. Primary data is you collect the data yourself. I can vouch for my data. This is my primary data that you say. Secondary data, somebody else has collected the data. I am using that data. What are the common sources of secondary data? I told you the number one source would be census. When I quote census, in India census in 2011, such and such things were reported. I didn't go and collect the data. I was not a part of the census, but I can report that, and thus it becomes an example of secondary data. As I discussed already, just those slides for future explanation. Nominal has names, there is no order. Blood group, A, B, A, B, O, there is no order in this. Other examples are occupation, food groups, skin color, and location of heart murmur. Dichotomous variables, two options: are you well, are you sick, normal, abnormal, male, female, treatment, placebo. Nominal and dichotomous data are called as discrete variables. Why they are called as discrete? Because nominal and dichotomous are categories which are completely separate from each other. So these categories are mutually exclusive, and therefore these two type of data is called as discrete variables. Coming to the ordinal variables, they are, as I said, ranked or ordered. So you have a classification there. Say for example, when you say that edema, none, 1 plus, 2 plus, 3 plus. So you mean to say that the edema is increasing. Similarly, systolic murmur, we say that it is grade 1 to grade 6. So that is a order there you have. Continuous variables. Continuous variables, you know, can be split. You can have multiple values. Say for example, height. I can have a person at 6 feet. I can have a person at 5'10". I can have a person at 5'11". And I can also have infinite values in between. So it is a very continuous scale. Okay, this is not mutually exclusive. This is not ordinal, got no names. It splits. So numbers as we know them, 1 to infinity. Numbers as we know them, you are talking about continuous variables. Ratio variables. Ratio variables are number where an absolute zero is defined. A notable example is a VAS scale, visual analog scale for pain. So that is part of the VAS scale. By the way, these types of scales are also called as Likert's scales, just in case they ask you in the examination. VAS scale is, you have this drawing and there are maybe 5 faces or 10 faces, and the first drawing has this and the second drawing has this. So absolutely worst pain that you can have, okay, that is 10, and as happy as you can ever be, no pain at all, that is on another scale. So this is an absolutely defined zero. Also, temperature scale, you have a Kelvin temperature scale where you have an absolutely defined 0, 1 degree, 2 degree, 3 degree. These kinds of variables wherein you have an absolutely defined 0 are called as a ratio variables. Coming to the graphical representation of data, you have simple bar chart, multiple bar chart, component bar chart, and pictogram, very commonly used. Rapidly, some examples. Simple bar chart. Okay, you know that this is a simple bar chart. Multiple bar chart. Okay, so you have two components. Let's say I give you further clarification. This was a male and a female here.
Now we are talking about Asia and Europe here, and you have a male here and female here, and male here and female here. So the information that I am trying to convey to you is going on increasing, and therefore this is a multiple bar chart, this is a simple bar chart. Component bar chart. Okay, that is a component bar chart. Say for example, male here, female here, male here, female here, and we are talking about say anemia and non-anemic. So in a single bar you have multiple components, that is an example of a component bar chart. Single bar, multiple components, component bar chart. I have two bars stuck up to each other, that is a multiple bar chart. Only a single bar is a simple bar chart. Pictogram is when you use pictures. When you use pictures for showing, say for example, I say our males are 50 in this group and 40 in this group. So here maybe I draw a male. I do this. Okay, this is a male. So I use pictures and therefore it is a pictogram. So these are the commonly used types. Some examples in front of you, what I just explained on the board. This is a component bar diagram. You can see multiple components in a single bar. Percentage bar diagram, a special type of component bar diagram where everything is expressed in percentage. So you have every bar which is going up to 100%, and then you have fractions in those bars. So that is a percentage bar diagram. What you have in front of you right now is a histogram. Histogram is when you have class intervals and the boundaries are near. So you have 0 to 10, 11 to 20, 21 to 30. In that case, you will have to have a histogram. So what you are seeing on in front of your slides right now is a histogram. Everybody knows this. Pie diagram. You have a pizza, you take a piece, I take my piece. That is a pie diagram. This is a frequency curve. If I join the midpoints of the histogram, the bars of the histogram, I can make a curve. I have tried to make this rough black curve here, and that is called as a frequency curve. This is called as a frequency polygon. What is the difference this and this? In a curve, I tried to make a curve, so you don't have angles there. In a frequency polygon, you can see that there are sharp angulations. The points which are joining show sharp angulation. So this is a frequency polygon when I joined the midpoints by lines and not curves. Frequency polygon, if you remove the bars, looks like this. Advantage of this is that the shape of the distribution is more easily seen in a frequency polygon than a histogram. So you can see what is the shape of the frequency if a polygon is given. This is an important advantage and may be tested. A miscellaneous method is the stem and leaf diagram. Not very frequently asked, but since it is not, has not been asked, I think it may be asked. Stem and leaf diagram is a very peculiar method of data representation, and it has got some peculiar advantages also. What it has got is that it has a stem, it has a leaf, and it has a hash, which I think you already know by now is a number. So you can have a 1, a 2, a 3, and then you can have here 1, 2, 2, 1, 3, 4, or say here 3, 4, 5. Okay, so you can have these sorts of things. How to read this? How to read this is, in this data set you have an 11, you have an 12. So this is the first digit and this is the second digit. For this, this is the first, this is the second. Here, this is the first number, this is the second number. So the data set here would have 21, 22, 23, 24. So in this data set you have these numbers. Similarly, here you would have 33, 34 and 35. Understood? That is how a stem and leaf diagram is read. The hash, that is the hash is n. How many observations are there? Here 1, 2, you have 2 observations. 1, 2, 3, 4, you have 4 observations. And 1, 2, 3, you have 3 observations. So this is a stem and a leaf
diagram. What are the advantages of the stem and the leaf diagram? One of the main advantages is if you tilt this like this, if I rotate the board like this, I can see what the frequency distribution looks like, because these numbers don't just tell me the value of that individual number, it also gives me how much of these values are in each class. Say for example, this was not just up to 3, it was 4, 5 and 6, and if I rotate the chart like this, just by looking at the edge of the numbers may look something like this, and then I say, okay, it has got a peak in this area. This is a very peculiar advantage offered just by stem and leaf diagram. Rotate this like this for this data set, that would look like, that curve would look like something like this. Okay, I have less values here, I have more values here, and I have the same number of values here. So you have 2 here, 4 here and 3 here. So I say that, okay, this is the group which has got the maximum number of observations. This is an advantage only offered by the stem and leaf diagram. Other advantage is, just by looking at the stem and leaf diagram, I can tell what number of observations are there in each group. So I can say 4 here, 2 here, 3 here, and that is very easily told. So these are some advantages of stem and leaf. It may come. With that, we move on ahead and we start with sampling. Sampling, as I have already discussed, is done because if I want data from a population, I cannot go to each and every household in the community and collect data. So therefore, what I do is I have a representative sample. So if I want to have the idea of this population, I cannot go to each and every individual of this population, but what I can do is, maybe I can take a small sample out of the population, I can collect data on these people, and then let me try to extrapolate this data on the population. Say for example, I want to know the height of people in India. This is Indian population. What I do is, I sample people from all over India, and then I try to extrapolate the height of Indian people based upon my sample size. So that is a sample. Coming to the methods of sampling, you have basically non-probability sampling and probability sampling. For all practical purposes, what matters to us is probability sampling. Non-probability sampling is purposeful sampling. So it is not sampling in the truest sense. It is not random and can be subjected to a lot of bias. Non-probability sampling examples, you have consecutive sampling. Consecutive is, you have a clinic, people are coming inside the clinic, as they come, you enroll them in the study. We saw what are the problems with that. That is a consecutive sampling. Convenience sampling is, you are trying to say, I chose a sample because I thought that it would be easy for me to include this person in the study. That is a convenience sampling. According to my convenience, I choose people. A lot of bias. Judgmental sampling is again based upon the disease characteristics or the characteristic you want to take, you choose the people. So not a very good method. Non-probability sampling, not a very good sampling method. Coming to the probability sampling methods. Probability sampling essentially means randomly. Okay, people might have chance that they randomly come into my study. I don't have much control over that. You have simple random sampling, systematic sampling, stratified sampling and cluster sampling. Since this is important, we are going to see what that is. Firstly, simple random sampling. Simple random sampling is applicable to small, homogeneous and readily available population. Every unit has an equal chance of selection, and we usually do simple random sampling by lottery method and random number method. If you remember our lecture on randomization, we had talked about these methods. So lottery method and random number table method help you to randomly choose a population. Say for example, simple random sampling is, I have a population of 100 people and I want a sample of 10. So I make 10 sheets with, say for example, a tick, and I make 90 sheets with a cross. I mix them up. I call all the students in my class to pick a sheet. If they pick a yes, they are included in the study. If they pick a no, they are not included in the study. Did I influence? I did not influence. They chose. Okay. Did they know where they are going? No, because it was a cheat. So that is a lottery method. Similarly, you can have a random number method. A Again, because it is simple, because it is random, it is called as a simple random sampling. Systematic random sampling. Now, systematic random sampling is a refinement of random sampling. What I do is, this is called as a frame. Okay, this is my sampling frame. The population from which I have to draw samples is called as a sampling frame. So about from my sample frame, I want 10 families to study. So my sampling interval should be less than 10. Obviously, if I have a sampling interval more than 10, I would need more than 100 families. How did I come to that? I divided 100 by 10 and I got 10. You don't want to know this, just remember, in systematic random sampling, you choose the kth house. So this becomes the kth house. What is the kth house? Is in every 10th house. Every 10th house. Either the 10th house or a number less than 10. I cannot have a number above 10 because I will have to have population above 100 then. Say for example, I arbitrarily choose, okay, 5th house. So I go into the population. It is a homogeneous population. And I go and choose every 5th house. I get to my sample size, that is 10 families, and I stop. That is systematic random sampling. When you choose every kth house or any number in that population, that is a systematic random sampling. It is random, but then there is a system there. The number of the house that I have to choose is predetermined. It can be a 5, a 6, or a 7, whatever. What does it depend upon? It depends upon my sampling frame. So every kth house I choose is systematic random sampling. We'll see the rest of the methods in the next class. Thank you.